Welcome, everyone. In one reading, The Nature of Architecture, a title suggested to me by Jorge, suggests the essence of architecture, or the natural within it, whether it be the forces of gravity or the temperature of air that whirls around it. Structure could be the nature of architecture, too, since it manifests forces of gravity. On the other hand, since we know that Jorge would not ascribe to the naturalization of architecture, we could have called tonight's event The Return of the Unnatural, a title which Peter suggested after I had already named the event. Or we could have called it The Return of Architecture, actually, since we have to say, actually, that it is artifice, never natural. And while no one would say that ecology is anything other than unnatural, first and foremost, the unnaturalness of architecture is a very different thing. And this, I believe, will be something we cannot avoid talking about tonight. Clearly, architecture has fought nature, but it has aligned with nature too, by abstracting it according to an idea, a system, or a form. The green ideology, on the other hand, more limitedly calls forth, in its most positivistic manifestations, functional parameters unrelated to architecture as artifice. With the new sustainable functionalism, artifice can only be accepted when it too becomes a commodity function. And yet, this must be renounced. If the ascendancy of sustainability and positivistic, scientistic, vitalist, and organicist tendencies replace artifice and representation, where does this put architecture? I'll refrain from a frontal assault, but I'd like to just give a little tap. The green is an ideological cover for the domination it perpetuates but claims to subvert. In the dream of totalization in which architecture, landscape, and planning are unified, what happens to the unnatural nature of architecture? It is a difficult question because architecture, by its nature, is incompatible with this functionalized unity since it always stands apart from it. Perhaps then we could ask the question from a different perspective. What would happen if architecture took over everything? If it grew like weeds, nothing regulating its bestial ambitions? It might turn out that we've seen this before in the poignant allegory of Piranesi's Campo Marzio, where the drive to take over everything turns the city into a monstrosity. Here and today once more, in order to set itself apart again, architecture will have to reinvent itself. Perhaps about this and other matters we will speak later, but for now, I would like to turn my attention to introducing our first speaker, Jorge Silvetti, our professor, former chair of architecture, principal of Machado Silvetti Associates. He has written many important pieces of architectural theory in which architectural culture is built through the consciousness of its history. Yet he has always been as interested in reflecting upon architectural autonomy as he is in the politics of architecture, as they play out in particular cultural conditions and in a resistant market economy with all its fashions and imperatives for pleasure and fulfillment. And this is one of the reasons that his positions on these imperatives related to the natural, so-called, are really important. But leaving nature aside, I did want to say one thing about Jorge's main contributions here at the GSD, his commitment to the disciplinary specificity of architecture after founding, as he did, the theory curriculum here at the GSD. And more, there was something else about Jorge I wanted to say, let's say important to note on this occasion, which is that his work has done so much to do to redirect our attention to the role of rhetoric in architecture, in our métier, all while everyone else has been denying it for so long, purging all of its effects. Only now everyone is realizing how important rhetoric is. And yet Jorge had been casting a wider net for quite a long time to define his own palette, an original dialectic between idea and reality, the plurality of cultural and methodological conditions that animate architectural production. And with that, let me introduce and welcome Jorge.
Thank you, Scott. And I've been told so many times that Scott to be so brief that I'm a little bit afraid how I'm going to read this. But okay, let's start. Scott attributed the title of this session, The Nature of Architecture, to me, and I should say something about it. It came about in a discussion with Erika and Scott last summer when they invited me to participate. Indeed, I was worried that in all the sessions that they conceived, we would be talking too much about nature and not enough about architecture. Because the problem we have is architecture. Nature is, it exists, architecture we must make. That's a big difference. Now, for what is to be a short presentation, I chose one of my favorite topics, which is what architecture looks like these days, and what that tells us about the state of the art and the state of architectural education as it started. And well, we must admit that if we consider the architecture which is proposed these days through magazines, competitions, and graduate theses, then architecture looks very much like nature. The polemics that I would like to add to this discussion in a nutshell is that architecture should not look like what it is not, for which we must first understand a few things about the nature of architecture, which I shall discuss only indirectly by focusing mostly on how nature enters into the equation of architecture. And since we're talking about titles, to speed up the argument paradoxically, I would like to discuss the title that I gave to my own short presentation. I have called this talk Block That Metaphor. For those not familiar with this expression, Block That Metaphor was the title of an absolutely delicious minuscule section that the New Yorker used to run weekly, little independent snippets functionally acting as graphic fillers at the end of full-length articles, where they quoted unfortunate metaphors that they picked up from other newspapers and magazines. This borrowing of the title is appropriate for me to get started because, on the one hand, my presentation today is also a snippet of what a full lecture could be, and on the other, we in this must block not only one, but many metaphors. So let's modify the title. It also helps me advance this talk to follow the New Yorker's model. The quotes I'm ready to mock will come without commentary. They speak for themselves. To this audience, it should be evident what it is that I'm referring to with these examples with which I want to start my argument. While any moderately educated reader could still pick up a reverse or mixed metaphor in a piece of writing, in architecture, the task of unlocking its mechanism of meaning is not so easy. The issue of understanding the efforts of literal biomimicry to create human environments, which instead should be conceived so that they help differentiate our acts from those of nature and in so doing to protect us from it, besides highlighting this inherent in cultural perversion, it opens up a myriad of doors of inquiry as to what this particular recourse to natural imagery means at this particular moment. Of all this, specifically the process of creativity is what I may want to take a first stab at. But let's not despair at the current and surprising recurrence, of literalism. Today, such formal repertoire and image sources per se do not threaten architecture too much. Mostly and sadly, their infantile plays point to naivete, usually coming hand in hand with ignorance, as such operations bring the process of design and architecture's efficiency lamentably close to that of magic in primitive societies, based on the similarities between forms, say, between the form of a garlic clove, just to bring a well-known example, and that of the human tooth, which are seen as having an affinity that would impart the garlic clove with the magic power to cure by touching a tooth in pain. But of course, in this case, it had a practical efficiency due to the chemical composition of garlic, not its form. This sympathy between analogous forms is not what worries me, although its recurrence today saddens me because of its insufferable intellectual poverty. As with all formal trends to which we all fall victims to in different degrees, we know by now that their effective life is not very long, and indeed we are seeing already the fading away of this naive naturalism. Nobody can take these images too seriously anymore. But in the naivete of the natural imagery, if the naivete of the natural imagery is fading, as the blobs' invasions receded about almost 8 years ago, when they threatened to leave on in their wake is an invisible and insidious metaphoric transformation insofar as their pretended attribute of being natural is transposed and transformed from palpable image to intangible process. Indeed, forms and metaphors are never innocent, and their appearances have consequences, particularly if they lie. And while one might be by now tired of these particular current metaphorical efforts and their aesthetics, their literal message of architecture as nature seemed to have worked with more efficiency as it migrated from the visual analog to the less tangible area of beliefs. In other words, what is happening is that the exercise of producing the visual metaphors has resulted in a silent, undetected reverse transfer of what these sympathetic forms suggest, namely that in addition to looking like nature, they are seen as being the result of a natural process of production, the very process of design. In yet other words, at the moment when these forms themselves are being discarded, they are not going into oblivion without leaving their mark. They are leaving behind with us their baggage, transferring their meaning, so to speak, following a process common in our culture, so prone to peripatetic semantics, from one practice to another, from one medium to another, in this case, from forms and images to processes. This is what some of the most exciting digital techniques of computation in their ability to manipulate, coordinate, and relate multiple variables and parameters have involuntarily enabled. The mesmerizing, almost sublime and confusing sight of the printers spitting hitherto slick unimagined images or 3D models of a representation of an architecture that looks like nature seduces the mind and induces it to think that the process of creating them, in which seemingly so little human intervention happened, is also natural, which is frightening corollary. That such state of mind, which has allowed architecture to think about itself as a result of a natural process so precise, so seemingly outside our hands, so under some invisible controls, sees then such results, formal, organizational, structural, not only as inevitable, but worse, as true. And then if the process produces truth, and here is the real problem, there is no need to assess the resulting form. Judging form is not important anymore. Or what is worse, we conclude, we have no power to act on it, so in the end, who cares? No wonder then that there is hardly anymore a discourse about ideas, which is what good architectural forms had always conveyed to us and provoked us with, but instead, there are conversations about how and what scripting program was used and to what purpose, or what are the appropriate algorithmic relationships of parameters, as if sorting out programs, verifying algorithms, and counting constraints was just like checking with the technical crew at an airport to make sure that all controls are in working order before the departure for a successful trip. This is not a very good metaphor. Should block this. Revivals might be always viewed as retrogrades, but when they are intentional, at least their purposes can be argued. But when they are the product of a lamentable ignorance of their own history, then conditions for disaster abound. Those current discourses which believe to possess the keys to an unimpeachable legitimizing process that consider the status of architectural form as insignificant and irrelevant, and which put emphasis on presumably measurable performance parameters, are all commonplaces that we visited before, in fact, quite recently. Personally, I had already been through one such fallacious conditions of which I was a willing victim. In the 70s, when I was working on my master's thesis at Berkeley, one of the rages, besides Christopher Alexander Patterson's language, which fortunately never seduced me, was that of general systems theory, a totalizing, synthesizing, multidisciplinary undertaking mostly promoted by behavioral scientists, but happily and enthusiastically embraced by architects, which attempted to describe and operate very complex social and ecological systems by means of sophisticated mathematical and statistical simulation models, which was, of course, when applied to architecture and design, soon fell apart against the intrinsic resistance of any cultural practice to yield to technocratic manipulations, and which myself, having written a rather boring master's thesis on that vein, if you can imagine me, writing about findings based on a statistical regression model that analyzed social networks in an urban area, but also the growth of the moose population in an island in Lake Michigan. That's what I did. But with this, it inoculated me forever of all the viruses of nature. Soon architecture fought back and with productive vengeance, giving us the best of theory and design that we had experienced in generations, and also the worst excesses of postmodernism. But what was good was that the critique, when at its best, acted as inspiration that came from cultural studies, literary criticism, history, anthropology, and all the human and hard sciences, and they came into architecture as well-formulated disciplines whose import, a well-understood architecture, could transform into new architectural products. But when, at its worst, architecture was only used to illustrate concepts from these fields without any transformative work, which is literalism. So we've been there. I do not know at what moment we stand in this current process, but it is beginning to be apparent that there are just too many illusions and mirages, too much magic thinking, too much infantilism around to be sustainable. So if we're not fools and learn from history, recent and past, then a serious attempt to change directions would be not only desirable, but imperative. This is a subject, of course, of another year-long seminar. What I would like to briefly do now is to sketch a script of how we got here. You see the garlic there? Okay. It seems that at least three conditions, all valuable and positive on their own, converge in time to produce an atmosphere prone to produce a wreckage. One, first, the environmental crisis and its consequences for architecture, the rain and sustainability. Second, the availability of new sophisticated computational techniques that allowed hitherto impossible formal explorations. And third, the lack of clear formal normative in architecture and its consequences, a liberating and energizing sense that all is possible with this ensuing torrent of formal experimentation. Good as they were, as they are, in and of themselves, their mixture was toxic and produced devastation. The script of this perfect storm could come more or less like this. The confluence of digital technology and formal liberation at a point in time both encouraged experimentation, but conversely created an immense vacuum in the discourse of architecture, as the architect was confronted with an infinite number of unexpected forms and not much to say about them. How to discourse about forms that were coming from scripted programs? That was the failure of the first wave of blobs. Nobody knew what to say about them. Enter both sustainability, carrying with it the unshakable authority of nature, on the one hand, and on the other, the ineffable and acute ability of architects to analogize form and construct metaphors, and the passage from those mute, smooth, rounded blob that had no story to tell, but we are eagerly looking at us as if to implore to give them meaning, the passage from them to loud metaphors screaming, "I am nature," was an easy step to take, so they could then be seen as bones, muscles, trees, glands, or geographies, and assume the authority that such condition would endow them with. Next step, if you believe them literally, You can also believe that they can perform the task implied by their metaphorical forms, and automatically verbs are naturally attached to them for actions they would perform, and the rest of the story is as I already described. We arrived to the believed, or we act as if the processes by which they have been generated is not just like a natural process, but it actually is one, and because it is, it can claim definitive authority. End of the discussion, end of architecture. What I can do now to round up this effectively is to give examples of productive, positive, and immensely creative relationships between the arts and nature, or more specifically, the knowledge of nature, which is the format in which nature should be brought into architecture, not as trees, grass, waves, clouds, or knolls. Let's just remember that we're still at work in an institution of higher education and not frolicking at a neighborhood summer party. Of the many periods I might have chosen, I settle on that particular effervescent decades that witnessed the passage from the Enlightenment to Romanticism, the decades around the turn of the 19th century. This particular period could be thought to be, if not similar to ours, at least able to present us with some characteristics that resemble some of our current predicaments and sensibilities. For this is an era, and I quote Friesenhagen, who I don't know who it is, but it's a good quote, an era when the arts were increasingly turning away from the frigid idea of the Enlightenment aesthetics and towards a new stress on imagination and feeling. And also an era of major scientific discoveries in which the word science was not yet being used in the same way we use it today, and so the activities of its practitioners were referred to as experimental philosophy. Somewhat closer to the idea of knowledge of nature that I'm referring to. It is interesting that in such productive decades, both artists and experimental philosophers had intense personal and professional relationships with each other and their disciplines. Thus, the founder of modern astronomy, William Herschel, was earlier in his life a first-class musician, a composer, and performer before devoting his life to the major discoveries that will change not only astronomy itself, but our understanding of the nature of the universe and shatter theological tenets and illustrate the idea both of the infinite and of the sublime forever. It is the time of Goethe, who writes the sorrows of young Werther and Faust, paradigmatic romantic novels, but also writes a theory of color, which in turn influences Turner's painting techniques, and who, while learning the art of the ancients during his grand tour in Italy, collects stone samples, investigates the formation of clouds, and experiences in situ the fear of an erupting Vesuvius. And it is the time of Humphry Davy, one of the founders of modern chemistry and disseminator of scientific ideas to the general public, who wrote some of his discoveries in verse, because he was an amateur, not so bad poet, who in this was encouraged by his close friend, no one other than Coleridge. Of these periods, there are two additional examples I want to illustrate in more detail. One is about Joseph Haydn, the great Austrian musician who, after a triumphant career, is invited as an honor guest to London in the last decades of the 18th century. He was the most acclaimed musician of his day, a man of the Enlightenment living the last chapter of his life straddling the century, and history has recognized him as the founder and inventor of what we still call the symphony form. What did Haydn do upon arrival? He had promised himself to write before dying something for which all times will remember him. And when in England, he proceeds to visit William Herschel, the astronomer, and an experimental philosopher. Wait a second, this is okay. And when at his place near Bath, he spends time at his famous one-of-a-kind 40-foot-long telescope staring at the universe for the first time, and then comes back to Vienna and fulfills his desire. He writes The Creation, the oratorium considered to be his most important and monumental masterpiece, in which he explores through sound and musical form the passage from chaos to nature. The other example I want to bring is Mary Shelley, the notable English writer. For a woman in this age to be interested in writing was already a somewhat unusual, if not unheard of, occupation and interest. If in addition to that, she was also seriously interested in experimental philosophy, It was almost inconceivable. Yet she attended religiously Davy's lectures on chemistry at the Royal Society and corresponded with German scientists of the day. She was interested in the hottest thing of the times, something probably comparable with our own excitement with all things digital today. That was electricity and all its associated phenomena, still unexplained but by then identified. She could not shake it off, and during her much written about fun summer of 1816 in Lake Geneva, not only for the flirtatious and frolicking menage a trois she had together with her writer husband Percy and the eccentric Lord Byron, she did what you already know she did so well. She wrote Frankenstein or the modern Prometheus. If there is a masterpiece of romantic writing and thinking, this is the one with all that tragedy and terror. I wish I could dwell more on the beauty of this novel, which I recently reread and found immensely satisfying and enlightening. Suffice it to say that the novel is unmistakably founded on the scientific, philosophical, and artistic discourses of the day. Her interest in electricity, which at the time was thought to perhaps hold the definitive explanation of the origin of life, is at the core of her disquisition about the nature of man, his ambitions, and the problematic desires to know and produce. That's the original frontispiece of Frankenstein. What I want to point out in closing is what is obvious but perhaps not apparent. These people were serious artists, but also they were serious about learning about nature. An attitude and rapport with nature so well captured by the quintessential romantic painter David Caspar Friedrichs. They went through pains to acquire its knowledge, to look seriously at nature, but when they came back to produce, they did so with the tools of their métier, which they never confuse with the thing they've learned. Mary Shelley wrote a novel, an extraordinary romantic novel, which by the way created a new genre, the horror narrative, and in so doing she reaffirmed her métier and advanced it. She did not turn her knowledge of chemistry, electricity, voltaic arches, etc., into the topic of what she wrote about, but used indirectly to construct and enrich a story with a message. She had a literary idea, not an electrical idea. Haydn, on his part, does the same. He learns and experiences the new universe, but then searches for a musical format that would allow him to narrate a sublime story and founds it in the oratory, a well-known centuries-old format at the time, but which he had never used before, allowing him to use the human voice in choral rendition together with a larger orchestra to produce the acoustic marvel that evokes the moment of creation in space. Nothing, however, excited, kept them away from their respective métiers, not they ever confused nature with what they were doing. No naive magic here, but profound intellectual rigor and integrity. Somehow we should regain that dominion of our own doings, the nature of what we do, i.e. the nature of architecture, before we venture to bring nature into it. To end on a light note, no pun intended, I prepare just a few seconds of illustrated music of Haydn, the creation. On the left, a photograph of a galaxy, which he probably saw on the telescope. On the right, the manuscript with a fragment where to listen. These are three representations of the same thing in different media: a photograph, the music itself, and a manuscript that on the vertical axis represents the space of the orchestra and horizontally the passage of time and its rhythm. They all address the sublime idea of a space infinite within their own substance and without betraying their own nature. No mixing, no blurring, no subsuming, and no confusion.
now I would like to introduce Sarah Whiting, Dean of Rice, theorist and co-principal with Ron Witte of the firm WW Architecture. Her biography stretches across many divides that would later produce the important synthesis that she has brought to the Academy here and in many places. Sarah worked, and we must look back at this for a moment, at OMA, Eisenman, Graves, and then, after that, PhD at MIT, where everyone knows she established a dialogue between formalism and democracy in mid-century architecture in a way it had never been done before. During those years, she was the review editor of Assemblage, and this turned out to be the platform that launched what has come to be called the Post-Critical Project, culminating in her perspective piece with Somel, Bob Somel, in 2002, in what has been called their hijacked issue of Log in 2005. Now, for years, the Academy invested in an intellectual project not easily reconciled with the aftermath of the fall of modernism, the aftermath that is sometimes called late capital. The modernist ambitions were overwhelmed by successive waves of post-modernization, and the schools retreated into esoteric theorizations that Sarah mercilessly criticized in an effort to free us to theorize subjects that were heretofore taboo, the overtly commercial, the effective, all of these things, as opposed to the withdrawn negative critiques that had stirred her own factions in the schools for several decades prior. For better or worse, we formalists have had to face the fact Sarah has contributed to a very potent challenge, a challenge putting many of our haunts at risk, and opening the discipline to deep incursions, destructive and productive, or destructively productive, incursions that could even include the environment, including the sustainable, all of these things to the extent that we can no longer take for granted, after Sarah, the idea that we in the schools must proceed with resistance as our modus operandi. Sarah does not let this slip into this pattern, into any routine, but rather articulates the field, slicing it horizontally and vertically, redirecting the lineages of the discipline, and thereby staging the emergence of a new generation. Welcome, Sarah Whiting. Welcome back, Sarah.
I just told Scott that was incredibly kind, but extremely hyperbolic. And you know, I thought already going after Haydn would be difficult, but going after that is hard as well. So I don't know what papers are here. Okay, it's nice to be back here. It's really wonderful to be back here, and it's nice to be surrounded by so many people. Although to be sandwiched between my former chair and my former boss is slightly nerve-wracking. So I'm going to go ahead and start. Where's the, do I do anything down here, Doug, to change the slides?
Yes, there's a silver controller on the podium.
Jorge? Oh, there it is. He hid it from me. Okay. All right, so thanks, sorry. I was sort of surprised by this session within the general arc of this symposium because I found it to be very tautological. And it's, I mean, if the whole symposium is about nature and architecture, I couldn't quite understand why there was a session specifically about nature and architecture. So that was the sort of circular logic, though I don't want to imply that Scott is a right-wing nut. He's a left-wing nut. So we know this actually follows very much on Jorge's talk, and I warn you that my talk is going to be fairly loose. But again, like Jorge, I would say that we know full well that nature is a longstanding and I would say tiresome at this point metaphor in architecture. As such, it offers an alibi for architectural production. And while it can be incredibly productive for some people, and Timothy Hyde actually has succeeded in convincing me that mimesis can be productive, he has a very interesting essay on that in the Serret book. Metaphor just isn't terribly interesting to me for the same reasons that, metaphors in architecture don't interest me simply because I'm more interested in the original than in the analogy. So rather than looking like I'm interested in looking good, or at least in producing a means of looking good in architecture. So we also know full well by now that nature is an obligation. It's a given in today's ecological disaster world. Nature or sustainability is as much a given as keeping out the rain. That's Houston, by the way, in a very rainy day. So we know that there are problems with ecology. We know that they exist. We know it's an obligation. So we know it's an obligation, but it's not an architectural project. It's an obligation for everyone. So I would say that's precisely why this symposium really hasn't engaged the technology behind issues of sustainability. That's not really the point of it. That's not a conversation or an argument. So to quote Scott, a symposium's goal is to foster the modalities of discourse to deploy an argument to produce a symposium's goal is to foster, oh no, sorry, I'm over, making it even more difficult, I'm repeating it, to produce a heightened level of historical consciousness. So it took me a while, but I finally have figured out that Scott gets paid by the prepositional phrase. So. So this is the goal of this symposium to produce a heightened level of historical consciousness and to produce an argument. So anyway, the obligation of nature in architecture can really be seen as problem solving. Of course, there can be particularly inventive solutions, innovations in materials, innovations in construction, innovations in technique. But those inventions or innovations don't tend to produce a heightened level of historical consciousness, and they also tend to require either an advanced knowledge of science and/or engineering, or they require knowing how to converse with engineers and scientists who possess that expertise. So that's not really the realm of architects, except for us to be able to communicate with those who possess that expertise. Though some people may make it their realm of expertise on top of an architectural education. So Scott made it clear to me that he didn't really want this session to focus on pedagogy, but really now, what's a girl to do? I'm less a material girl right now than a curricular one, and so it's impossible for me not to consider the implications that the obligation of nature can have on a school, and more generally on the direction that a school can take. So I'm less concerned with or able to talk about what's the matter with nature than what's the matter with architecture. Honestly, I'm discouraged by the lack of interest in or maybe fear of architecture itself in our field, as well as our discipline, that is in practice as much as in the academy. If you go to thesis reviews, you'll hear students talk about everything around our field. Most of their presentations are taken up by analysis of some phenomenon in another field, and then the architectural hypothesis gets tacked on almost apologetically. Clearly done hastily towards the end of the thesis process and presented hastily at the review. There seems to be no confidence either among students or their advisors that the stuff of architecture, dare I say the nature of architecture, that is floors, walls, ceilings, columns, and the vertical circulation connecting floor plans, whether that be stairs or elevators, has any significance, and yet that's the stuff that we have at our disposal to affect all other realms. In other words, we organize and form the world around us. That's pretty heady stuff. And is that why people don't really want to talk about architecture? That they're afraid that that's too heady a thing to address straight on? I would argue, and perhaps I sound incredibly conservative in doing so, but I would argue that architecture is still comprised of commodity, firmness, and delight, although today those categories really should be recast as program, technology, and form. We're not trained as scientists or engineers to engage sustainability, infrastructure, information in any sustained manner, though we are capable, and this series has shown that to be true, of affecting those fields and offering interesting commentaries or discussions to those fields. Nor are we adequately prepared as philosophers to take on the question of the sublime. We are, as we all know, as a little typo there, generalists, and the generalist mantle has only grown larger day by day. So clearly, that produces an enormous amount of anxiety, and that's probably the sort of natural state within architecture. And there's a desire or a hope for objective criteria. So the NAB's 34 performance criteria, they recently trimmed it down from 37, as if anyone noticed. They have these performance criteria which offer boxes that we can check off with the confidence of a black dot, saying that they tell us that programs must provide information demonstrating performance in certain areas through quantifiable measures. So, for example, design thinking skills has to, in order to be able to check that box, you have to demonstrate the ability to raise clear and precise questions, use abstract ideas to interpret information, consider diverse points of view, reach well-reasoned conclusion. So it's this desire for these objective criteria that sort of hovers over us. And I would say that actually the question would be, and the question that haunts the symposium is actually, how do we know whether we're doing anything that's good at all? What are our criteria? How do we judge? How do we formulate a project? And I think that's actually our job right now within architectural schools, and it probably always has been, is to help to articulate really how to formulate a project and what an architectural project is, and to give students the confidence that they can find a project within architecture, that to make a project interesting doesn't have to come from outside. I am intrigued by the fact that in the symposium statement, there seems to be a nervousness about form and its role that it can play, because there's in this quote from Scott, and I would like to talk about this actually in the discussion if possible, there's a sort of critique of modernist formalism, claiming that it went too far into the autonomy of art, and a potential critique of sort of bio-environmental formalism also. And what I sort of conclude from this statement is that there's a critique of both camps for their formalism, which surprises me a little bit that Scott would put that on the table. So maybe we can get at that in the discussion. So the next part of this, which is going to be fairly brief, is an attempt to address, let's say, one perceived assault on architecture, which is media, and the superficiality that emerges from media, and how, rather than see that as something to lament or critique, how I'd like to propose a way of seeing that as forming a project, ideally a sort of projective direction. And I would say one small correction to Scott's extremely kind introduction would be that I've never used the term post-critical, and I don't ascribe to the post-critical, that the projective is a different term. So, but to the topic that I wanted to talk about is this: the media and how the media has been, how the advent of media, and already I would argue in 64, 67, so we have here the Society of the Spectacle, Guy Debord on the left, Marshall McLuhan, 1964, the medium is the massage on the right. So already in the 60s, the sort of argument of mass media, and that's something that has only accelerated recently in terms of this sort of assault of media offering an extremely two-dimensional world that's purely mediated, that's purely superficial, that's purely rapid, that's led to the sort of immediacy of information and the desire for this sort of superficial connection. So rather than lament that, bemoan the sort of problem that this advent of superficiality and the screen has given us, I'd like to sort of search for a different kind of fatness, let's say, within that superficiality, within that two dimension, and sort of advocate a project of the 2.5D. that in rather than seeing, if you see this sort of avatar audience as being completely unchanged from the audience of the cover from Debord's Society of the Spectacle, I would say that there's a possibility for finding within contemporary society a possibility of differentiated audiences. So let me go back. So just as a sort of footnote, my general interest is in how program form and technology, so commodity, firmness, and delight, can affect how that creates a different form of architectural audience through this effect of program and form, especially. So if you consider the audience of modernism, and this is a series of Bauhaus masks, as implying that the audience of modernism in its sort of incipient stage is an audience of singular mass, that I would argue for a sort of bas-relief audience or a 2.5 audience emerging already in the initial critiques of modernism in the mid-century. So looking back to the 1951 CM8 and the development of trying to, an argument that's trying to articulate a differentiated public, a differentiated audience. And this is going to skim over a lot of work that I've done historically and as a designer, an attempt to sort of demonstrate an interest in how program form and technology affect audiences through architecture, both with historical examples and with our own work. So part of what I argue in other places and have argued here in a lecture before is the development of a sort of bas-relief modernism that emerges in the mid-century with an example on the near south side of Chicago. So how the Near South Side offers a scale of city that is neither tower in the park nor a homogeneous field, modernist field, but is a combination of these two in terms of a sort of bas-relief modernism that tries to offer differentiation within a system that's recognizably a system or a singular whole. And there's the Lake Meadows project from within that project, just as an example of a single project with its differentiation within. And just as a way of sort of reading that kind of 2.5 as how I see that offering an interesting project in other work, and so it's a lens through which I find some work being particularly interesting. So a way of saying that's my project and that's how I look at architecture. I would say that the reason I find the OMA project for Leal more interesting than the David Monjean project that won is in the offering of this sort of 2.5 size of these stubby towers in the OMA project in terms of offering a new possibility for Paris through this new typology. So I'm skipping around deliberately, but just to show the sort of possibility of developing an argument about a project through something that's perceived as a problem or an assault on architecture's nature and how a different project can emerge from that assault. So in the Neutlings Rydeck media building, I'm not interested reading that as a pure surface condition or two-dimensional condition, but how these blurred images that were taken from the newspaper and then turned into a fritted glass, how that creates a depth in that facade that has at once a singularity of the two-dimensional but offers a depth inside and sort of challenges that single superficiality. Similarly, I would say in Sana's work that one finds that complication of the superficial through the single materiality of the glass, or in Chinese high-rises. So again, I'm saying this is the lens through which I look at a lot of different work right now and why I find it interesting. So the possibility of reading in this mass housing, the possibility of a different form of urban depth through a sort of 2.5 that happens at the horizontal, at the vertical. Now, Zeynep Çalık-Alexander, who was a student here at the GSD doing her master's when I was teaching here, recently lectured at Rice and offered a very interesting example of August Endel, who also sort of made a discussion of space through its shallowness and an articulation of the possibility of how shallow depth offered a new conception of space at the beginning of the 20th century. So all of that is, again, a sort of quick surf through different projects that I think offer a different genealogy of a modern project that one can find in recognizing a way out of the problem of the superficial by finding depth within the superficial. And then just to end, let me show you very quickly a project that so Ron and I did as a competition last year, or 2 years ago, it was for a sound barrier for Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam. And so it was to just protect a zone from the sound of the airport. Okay. Technology. I'm stumped. How do I get rid of the poor Doug? Huh? It's gone. Okay. We're all right. So where's the where's the laser pointer? You have a separate pointer. Okay. All right. So essentially this was you were supposed to create just a sound barrier for this runway that would offer then 2 million square feet of developable land beyond that. And that was the part that interested us. And so the idea of how do you create a sound barrier that's not just a wall but starts to actually offer a new territory for development. So this project of ours has a graphic, has an interest in the sort of superficial reading of that of the scheme, but our interest is less in that superficiality or graphic than it is in how we took all of the obligations of the scheme in terms of we put together roads, footpaths, bicycle paths, terraces, and then these acoustic scoops, and how that can create essentially a new landscape and a new development that would be, again, at this sort of bas-relief scale. So just quickly to show you the project beyond there. So that's what you see from the airplane. Now, the project that won, I can read the quote, was a winning design for an innovative noise reduction facility, which achieved the highest scores in terms of sustainability, innovation, and noise reduction. So essentially, demonstration of an argument that the criteria that are given to us for success within our field have been these sort of objective, these desires for some form of objective criteria. And just to sort of make a claim, essentially, an argument for some possibility of an architectural project maintaining its forces or resisting that overwhelming objectivity that lies out there. So the mandate, I would say, is for us to look out at the world anew and look good. And with that, I close.
And now it's really an honor to introduce Peter Eisenman. During an evening in which the unnatural or artifice are salient problems, it must be said that he has advanced the discipline singularly through a critical redefinition of architecture as a language and as a mode of thought, in opposition to the prevailing ideologies that privilege a positivistic role for architecture, the functional, or the now so-called performative. Throughout his career, Eisenman's methods of design and teaching have produced profound knowledge of the forms and underlying principles of classical and modern architecture alike, not by any reduction to ungroundable essences, but rather in his corpus and in those of the numerous architects that he has analyzed, through a kind of process in which texts and buildings become testaments to historical processes, possible futures, in a ceaselessly critical process. And by critical here, I mean a pedagogy, a project, a productive project. I don't think anyone else has made more productive the process of working through problems than Peter has. Now, you know, because in his renunciation of literal meaning, he has bracketed architecture in order to establish its meaning within itself, and in this way set the stage for a theoretical encounter with other disciplines, a multidisciplinarity of a very different kind than what we are seeing today. With Peter, the relationship between object and subject, form and function, building and landscape, artifice and nature are all radically rethought. Thank you for coming, Peter. Welcome.
Thank you, Scott. Returning to some of my greatest catastrophes and fondest memories, I was trying to think why Jorge Silvetti and I, 25 to 30 years ago, were supposedly thought to be at odds, because I agreed with everything he said. And I thought to myself, it must be something wrong. As in Hamlet, time is out of joint. I think time must be out of joint if we can't find something to argue about. I have the distinct dysfunction of having to speak tomorrow as well as today, so I've saved my slides for tomorrow. So I have actually 50 slides. I could have shown 25 tonight, 25 tomorrow, it wouldn't have mattered. They're all the same thing. but any case, I want to say that unfortunately also I didn't read the prospectus, and so therefore I didn't know what we were really talking about tonight. But now that I find out we're talking about the nature of architecture as the subject, I think, oh my God, I can do that. Because I see the nature of architecture as a sentence parsed in two ways. One, nature as a noun, which then would refer to the natural, etc., produced a natural condition produced by architecture, or the nature of architecture as an adjectival form talking about this discourse. And for me, if I can roll into the adjectival form, I'm at home at discourse. So I don't feel anything unnatural about tonight, because I can talk about the nature of architecture. With that as the background to what I'd like to say, I want to refer to two modest occurrences which happened to me over the weekend. One was at my institution, affectionately called here the University of the South. And there was a lecture by a noted architect, Frank Gehry, which was for the consumption of our recruiting day. And Mr. Gehry had a packed house, and of course this is all being broadcast to his office as we speak, so I have to be very judicious in my way of addressing this lecture. In any case, Frank showed 30 new projects, all done within the last 6 months, it would seem to me. all the most enormous scale, and you know, I thought to myself, and I was sitting next to Kurt Foster, who is a scholar of this sort of phenomena. And I said to him at one point, which is a good one? And he said, he looked back at me and he said, that's not the point. And I said, oh. I said, well, what is the point? And he said, an eye. You've got to have an eye. And I thought, oh, okay. I don't have an eye, and I have never had one. And so I had a very difficult time with this 30-building lecture, because I'm always looking to say, is there a good one? And I also believe that, in fact, if you have an understanding of Jackson Pollock or Jasper Johns or even the Bronzino show that's at the Metropolitan now, you can assess a good one from a bad one, because the critical mechanism for understanding, that is the nature of what it is within the work itself. And that's what I found so absent in this 30-building array. I couldn't figure out what was the discourse that I was witnessing. So there it is on the one side, the extremes of the eye. The second was in my New York Times on Sunday. I would imagine, given the length of time it took me to read it and the sort of congealed nature of my mind after I finished, Paul Krugman's what I assume to be 40 pages on the economics of global warming. And I read it page by page, word by word. And the thing I was most astounded by, there wasn't one mention of the word architecture, building, sustainability, etc. And I thought, isn't that strange? Here's a man who is devoting his energies today to discussing the economies, that is, how can we make a sustainable environment, and the discipline which we are all mostly concerned with didn't even feature. I think we all should take that with, think about that, because we think we are a relevant discipline, we all do, and of course, as we know, when you get out of the GSD, the salary you make is not going to be commensurate with the salary made by people who leave the School of Business here or the School of Law. I've always thought that to be an amusing discourse. In any case, on the one hand, we have Gary. On the other hand, we have Krugman. So then I say, okay, I can't deal with either of those phenomena, you know, because they're clearly, I'm not irrelevant to either of those discourses. Let me work on what Scotty was talking about. That is, what was architecture as opposed to nature? That is, artifice and representation. And I don't agree that that's what architecture is about. That is architecture as seen as a metaphysical discourse and within the metaphysical dialectic. And of course, if we continue to understand architecture as the locus of metaphysics, then we will come up with these kinds of permutations. Now, let's go and say, what would be the metacritical categories which would, in fact, describe the possibilities of dealing with artifice and representation. For me, architecture has always been, since first reading Gideon's Space-Time and Architecture, has always had something to do with the relationship between the object and the subject, that is, the space that we are in and our beings, and the time of our occupation, as well as the space of that occupation. And so space-time has always been the calibration for me of what constituted the metaphysical project. And I would argue that the way it is defined in architecture are through two terms. One, genius loci, and the other, zeitgeist. And I want to then move, going backwards, to a moment in time between 1968 and 1972, when these two terms were effectively produced by the pair Robert Venturi and Denise Scott Brown. What Robert Venturi did with Complexity and Contradiction was write the manifesto, which was to usher in a new discourse or a new episteme or paradigm in architecture, postmodernism. And so what it did was to change the moment in time that we were operating in from late modernism to postmodernism. And therefore, I would argue that it was a zeitgeist phenomenon. Now, in 72, a second book came out of this union, and that was Learning from Las Vegas. And if nothing else, Learning from Las Vegas pointed out the idea of a genius loci, that now we were not only in space and time, but we were in place and time, and that Las Vegas was a moment that expressed the contemporary condition of the world of the urban and the world of building. Now, we have, following from that, a whole set of discourses which changed the face of architecture, I would argue, from 1968-72 to the present. And I would argue that we are still within a postmodern episteme, even though people would argue that there's been a digital revolution. I think the terms, the metacritical terms, genius loci and zeitgeist, are with us. But what has happened is that, and I think this is where the imagery of today is very different than the imagery of the 68 and 72 moment, and that is the scale of what is considered place and the moment in time of what is considered place. In other words, where is something? Now, in 5 hours in 1968, I could get to my alma mater, Cornell, and it didn't seem like it was too bad because that's about as far as I could go with normal transport and that was available to me. Today, in 5 hours, I can go to Los Angeles, I can go to Mexico City, I can go to even to London. Why would I go to Ithaca? Of course, Moisson has been arguing that ever since he left. But I can't find a reason to go to Ithaca, and I can't get anybody to go with me. So that the notion of the distance and time, where you can get in 5 hours, that is the space and time of technology, has changed the world. But what has also happened, because of the scale and the space and the time changing, the relationship of project to capital has also changed. And this is what has what I consider undermined the terms genius loci and zeitgeist. Because while you could argue that the Venturis in 68 to 72 reached what I would call an accommodation with capital, and that postmodernism in its essence was an accommodation with capital, no longer is architecture even thought of as necessary to accommodate capital. Capital deals with architecture in a much more rough and grotesque way, because it is no longer possible to do a small building, have a small office in the traditional sense of the word, because project means at a large scale. You have the West Side Yards project, which is an enormous condition. You have projects all over the globe that take on a scale that is beyond, in a sense, a comprehension. And so therefore, it's when you see 30 projects of Frank Gehry's in 6 months production, you realize that it's necessary to sustain itself to keep up with capital development. I have a friend of mine who came to me about 6 months ago and said, I have to do a new town in China for 3 million people. And I thought, oh, a new town for 3 million people. Well, and I thought, what are you going to do? Do you have an idea? And of course, there are no new ideas about towns for 3 million people, because they're not based on ideas. They're based on the market. They're based on capital expansion. And so what we have seen is the undercutting of place and time in a way that in the year 2000 and 2010 could not have been predicted with the notions of genius loci and zeitgeist. I witnessed a presentation by Liz Diller, who showed very clearly how this has happened. And she was talking about a Venice that has now been reproduced in Las Vegas. It's been reproduced in I think, Macau, and is being reproduced all over the world, so that we now have the reproduction of these places. I was surprised when I went into the Newark airport recently, there was a Brooks Brothers. Now, in my time, Brooks Brothers had a shop on Madison Avenue. There was just one shop. It was a genius loci. All of us who were at Harvard, Yale, Princeton, and other assorted Ivy League institutions dressed there. It was the place to dress. But never in the Newark airport, which is a B-grade airport, if anything. And I was moved to ask the woman at the shop, does anybody buy anything here? And I said, because I don't think it's the right clientele for Brooks Brothers. Oh, she said, oh, yes, we sell things all the time. And I also remember, in a certain sentimental and nostalgic way, when one would have to go to the Faubourg Saint-Honoré to find an Hermès. There are now 12 Hermès's in Las Vegas. So clearly, place has been eaten up by capital and by what I would think as branding. Now, so what are we to make of this in terms of the nature of architecture? Well, first of all, I don't think we can go back and to the concepts of genius loci and zeitgeist, because they have been undermined by capital, and we're certainly not turning capital back. So the question is what to do. And I think the thing is that if we assume that genius loci and zeitgeist are part of what one would call the metaphysical dialectic, and if we're saying that, in fact, the metaphysical dialectic is the problem, well, you could argue that capital already has overcome the metaphysical dialectic. And if, in fact, one is trying to rethink that project, capital has already done it for us. So the real question is, do terms like genius loci and zeitgeist have any viability in the notion of a nature of architecture today? And I would say is that capital, if we assume that capital is the consumer of metaphysics, and that no place as an idea is with us. In other words, the Denise Scott Browns of today sitting in this audience, if you were asked, where would you go to write the learning from Las Vegas of today? The answer is you can't go anywhere. And so therefore, if you can't go anywhere, if there ain't no place, and there ain't no time anymore, because time is instant, because I don't need to wait nostalgically for my New York Times to be delivered on my doorstep at 6 o'clock in the morning. I can get up at 5:15 and read the New York Times on my computer. I still am very fond of the nostalgia of the actual paper, but so for me, the real question is, if in fact my view of the world is in fact a possible view, what is it that we teach here at Harvard about the nature of architecture? What is it that we teach? Do we have an old-fashioned idea of what it might be, or a nostalgic idea of that? And I say the same thing for my institution and other institutions like it. And since we are talking about three different institutions tonight, perhaps we can ask the question, or the audience can ask the question, what is it that we teach all of you for $52,000 a year? And why is it relevant to what you might be able to do in the future? Now, supposedly, at one point in time, when we saw Bilbao, it was a meaningful exercise in the possibility of architecture reasserting itself as an urban phenomenon. Can that same thing be said today with the 30 little Bilbaos that have just sprung up all over the world? I don't think we can. And of course, without being too critical of Sarah Whiting's pronouncement about Les Halles, the project of REM was the project of the City of the Captive Globe 30 years ago, which was didactic and symbolic and a very provocative discourse. I don't think today it's any longer provocative, and I would like to discuss that with Madam Whiting. And I'm not convinced that the provocative discourses that all of us, Jorge, myself, Scotty, and others, produced in our time and are still producing today have any relevance. Now, for me, at my advanced age, I don't have a problem with that. In fact, I have made a discourse out of what I call lateness. And I'm very late in both place and time, my own time, but also in the time we are in. And lateness doesn't help all of you who are great desire to be avant-garde, to change the world, to produce the new again. And I'm not convinced, as Sarah knows, I've given this talk before, that this part of it, that we are in a moment in time, given the circumstances that we find ourselves in, that anything but an inquiry into the possibility of the late, that is, inquiry into the possibility of the fact that time is out of joint, is anything but playing on a nostalgia and a sentimental past. Thank you very much.
Oh. Okay. I don't know if this is on. Can anybody hear? Is it audible? Okay. I have a question for each of you, though. Depending on what happens, I may only ask the first of you. And going along with the order, I would like to start with Jorge. You talk positively about artists' relationships with scientists, about the idea that the experimental philosophers and the artists were working together, but that there was a moment when they understood how to remain within their métier. And this was something you wanted to make very clear, that there wasn't confusion about the matter of the métier. And yet, I would like to ask you, in the current context of the interdisciplinarity that's kind of taking hold.
Can you turn your volume down?
How do you... There's another phenomenon. There's another problem, though, I wanted to ask you about, which is that while you said that, you also said that there was a problem in defining what we understand to be the norms, the basis for the discipline. Mm-hmm. You yourself said that. So I'm wondering how you proceed with the idea of the métier under the conditions that we don't know so well what defines it.
That's a difficult one. I'm going to try to go around it a little bit. I think that, you know, from a certain perspective, there is nothing new in today's interest in what goes on in science and art and things like that. We are all in with all we've been. It's a part of being an architect. That's Sarah maybe said it a little bit too lightly for me, but she did say, you know, that we are generalists. I want to believe we are not generalists, but we do have a tendency, more than other disciplines, particularly when you look at the university, to actually reach out, probably more individually than institutionally, to other things than, you know, lawyers and doctors and business administrators do. So there is nothing new, but I do also share the kind of sense we all have that we need to expand in certain directions what we do, or at least when we're in school, what we learn. What I am not certain, so you know I don't have an answer to that yet, is that what we've been trying to do, what I have done myself, because I haven't found any other format, is really the way to go. That these convergence in space and time in which we all begin to do things together with other disciplines in school is going to produce anything, really. I'm not sure. Again, that seems to be the prevalent model, seems to be nothing to really differently than that to do. But I am really concerned about its efficiency. There is an inherent contradiction. I mean, I remember having that discussion with actually Gerald McHugh in my very first year I was here, so that's a long time ago. In which I insisted, you know, because he really wanted also to integrate, that was the word at the time, integrate everything and just put it on the first semester. And of course, you know, there it was clearer, you know, you integrate when you have something to integrate, or you first have to teach something, and then at some point you would integrate. So the model that probably I have followed more, which is that within our structure, this is kind of boring what I'm saying, but within the school, to focus more on sort of connections with other disciplines in the upper levels rather than the lower level, let's say option studios and not the core, is the one that will still prevail. As far as what it is that we should teach, that I leave it to you. You run the core, not me. And you have very strong ideas.
He's going to tell us.
He's going to tell us no matter what.
No, I'm going to answer. I mean, Sarah,
yeah.
I have to say, your question, I don't need to ask it, but if you put it on the screen, so brilliantly put, and it was your first act as dean. What's the matter with architecture? You've got to tell us now, because you said that there is a serious problem, that it is being tacked on, that it has lost a grounding, as an argument.
Yeah.
You know, really, we're looking for something. I mean, Peter has said, you know, I don't think we can do anything but to, you know, recognize that we can't wallow in the past. You know, well, what's the matter with architecture right now, Sarah?
I want to do sort of a version of blending Jorge and Peter, I guess. But in that, I think that the
you're already blended.
You're blending pretty well tonight. I would argue that we are generalists and that the only effective generalist is from your disciplinary ground, but that our role is to communicate with other disciplines by not by being them, and that was my argument against sort of that the projects that try to be within other disciplines, but that we have to communicate with them. But I think Peter's provocation of the sense that there's not a possibility for innovation right now and we're in a late moment, and I appreciate your recognizing that that's easier for you to say than for people of other generations, and I would put myself sort of happily midway between you and most of the audience. It's harder for us to hear that, let's say, and as which you recognize.
But you could argue it's a positive condition. It's
yeah, done yet. Okay. I mean, I would argue that I think that what's interesting is so, no, I've gone out. That's okay.
Here.
I would argue that this one is okay.
Here, you hold it.
I'm not sure where I was. That I think that is a positive moment of saying okay that the idea of pure invention is relatively futile right now, and that's why, I mean, I would say I offered a kind of messy view of trying to have a project that can skate across, for me, history, theory, and architecture, which is the three fields that I want to be part of, but that can still be a project by cutting a different slice through something that exists and seeing how it can affect us in terms of practice today. And so that's a way that saying it's not looking for pure novelty, but it's also not lamenting the problem of or saying that we can only lament the situation that we're in. So to respond to you, that what's the matter with architecture is the lack of belief in architecture offering us ways for advancing, and I think that we have to get beyond that.
But I also thought, and I know you knew well this, and I want to just remember it, that, you know, what's the matter with architecture is, you know, what is in it. You know, it's a little bit of the play on words.
Yeah.
And that you
I,
knew full
I
well.
I was schooled in the 80s.
We just need to start to look to the something to answer this. Peter, you were about to say something to Sarah. I'm gonna, you know,
no, I was before.
And about the possibility that this is a condition that's productive.
I wanted to speak to two other weekend phenomena. Had a busy weekend. I rewatched Heimat, Edgar Wright's 15-hour magnum opus, and I watched again preparing for tonight, because that's what I was going to talk about. White Ribbon, the Michael Haneke film. And first of all, I thought there's an enormous invention in Haneke, and he clearly had seen Reitz's, you know, and been part of what Reitz was about. But what I thought was interesting about the difference between Heimat and White Ribbon, Heimat plays with color and black and white, with light, shadow, etc., all of the visual properties of cinematic media. Haneke takes a color film and drains it of its color and shows it in black and white, and it's very different than having a black and white film, number one. And what he does is he says clearly that he's against the hegemony of the visual. In other words, as a late project. In other words, the visual having dominated modernist sensibility from the beginning of the 20th century. He says that his films are about orality, about the silence, about stillness, about, and not about, you know, great spectacular things, which are the thing of Avatar, the sort of spectacular moment of today, the attempt to try and be new, caught in this terrible vice of not being able. And what he's doing is looking into film, and I think White Ribbon is a stunning film, as I think many of his films are, which are exploring the media in a way that is involved with, allows for the late. And Edward Said's book, Late Style, Adorno's book about late style, all talk about the productive possibilities of the moment of lateness, whether it be Beethoven's Missa Solemnis, whether for me it's Thomas Pynchon's Against the Day, which is very much a late work, are all very productive. And I believe you don't have to be 77 to be dealing with lateness. I think you can be 25 and deal with the phenomenon of lateness. And so that's what I meant, that I think I was trying to suggest that all these new things, trying to do 30 projects in 6 months is nutso. You don't have 30 ideas in 6 months if buildings are about ideas or about some critical resonance. And I thought if we could all just, you know, stop for a moment and maybe drive to Ithaca for 5 hours instead of flying to Mexico City, et cetera, and experience what it's like to be late and slow, that it might be a good thing.
Well, see, that last part, though, starts to offer a kind of nostalgia.
No, I didn't mean
it. And that's, I think you should have stopped before driving
okay.
to Ithaca.
Well, I drive to Ithaca a lot. So, yeah. I have a son there.
I know.
So I do there. I mean, I'm very nostalgic about that, by the way. But I also, you know, don't get me on to Cornell.
You know, Peter, one of the things you express nostalgia for is, you know, it's striking, I'm sure, for many, although I've heard you do it before. You know, the paper. I mean, the newspaper.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, is the material realization of these experiences. And, you know, all of your dreams have been fulfilled.
Can I be nostalgic?
In the digital world, with the digital world. I mean, in a way, it's the world you always asked for.
Right.
And now it's here. It's been here. And you want to go to a material condition, the thing that you fought. I mean, you know, the embodiment of things and the tactile.
But I collected books and paper. Yeah. I've been a paper rat all my life. I write in my books all the time. I can't write on my computer.
No, but that's not what I mean.
Well,
I mean,
that's part of it.
I'm just talking about your architecture. I mean, in a way, this says yeah. something. I mean, your dematerialization of architecture, mm-hmm. the distancing from that, what you call metaphysics of the presence, you know, is everything that this is about, that you're now lamenting the loss of. Isn't it?
Yeah, you got me. I'm stuck.
We don't have to do the discussion tomorrow. Thank goodness.
I'll just show the pigs.
Okay.
Maybe we have questions.
Oh, yeah, we got some questions from the floor. Let's do that.
Michael.
You need a mic.
Hey.
Michael needs a mic.
Come down. And
why don't you steal one of
the
mics?
Oh, the microphone.
Here he comes.
Oh, there
microphone.
It is.
Yeah.
There you go.
Right. I don't quite have this, okay? There's something about the work we all admire, whether it's music, whether it's architecture. There's a sense that for the author, there's something out of reach. There's some authority, some legitimation, some goal that necessarily remains out of reach and drives the desire to produce, right? And it seems to me that part of there's one more step.
Are you generalizing, or is this about architecture only?
I'm generalizing at the moment because I think thinking of Adorno's book on Beethoven's late style, that technique had accumulated to the point almost of, he could almost do anything, but the technique was exhausting him, but there was something still out of reach that he wanted to achieve that drove him, kept driving him forward. So in a moment I'm generalizing, but I think if we take Peter's into the zeitgeist end of genius loci, there's also the end of this kind of otherness or this out of reachness that we don't believe in those kinds of authorities and those kinds of inaccessibilities because everything is incident and everything is accessible. And in some sense, the end of that inaccessible otherness is the end of the subject itself, which is in this case architecture. However, the cases of lateness that you're citing, like Beethoven, what happens afterwards is not a return to the nature of architecture, it's the absolute taking apart of the métier. It's after late Beethoven is Schoenberg. And after, right? So there's something, I'm afraid that we may
be... You're skipping Wagner.
No. well, okay, but okay, but I'm afraid we may be getting ourselves into a situation where we're actually afraid of a break. We're afraid of discontinuity, and discontinuity may be exactly what we're going to have, right? Mm-hmm. We might have to start again. Not abandoning the métier, because Schoenberg didn't abandon it. He took it apart.
Sure.
But I don't see anyone trying to take architecture apart in that way. We're trying to recover something, it seems, rather than take apart.
Well, I think there are young people. I would disagree with you. I think there's some very interesting young architects who, in their own way, are trying to take architecture apart. But I don't necessarily want to go into the. I would argue another red line that I had around my text, which I didn't say, is that to me, any discipline is based on its continuity and its life is based on what I would call states of exception. And if you take that as core, then taking something apart is always what a discipline is mm-hmm. about when it's alive. And it's not just Schoenberg, it's any moment in time that you're taking something apart. So I think that's a very productive view of today.
And there is, I take a positive view of the problems that we have, because, I mean, there are all these other pragmatic things that we are not including in our discussion, which is, you know, the real world, not nature, but the real world, which, you know, it always is feeding, you know, either all or, you know, late or early or young and old, with problems for which we have to respond, you know. I mean, buildings are not going to go away. Just the housing problem in the world is something that that keeps on recurring, and somebody is going to answer. And I agree. The idea then, when confronted with that, that we then may take it apart, is a valid one, because actually we have to continue to build. I mean, I'm positive in that sense. It's not that because it seems to be that now we don't have the kind of answers, you know, that in high moments of architecture we have, it is the end of it. I mean, I entirely agree that that the wheels keep on moving, and they generate the opportunity to precisely put it apart, and that has been done so many times. I mean, it's not just all of these people. I mean, Haydn, I mean, he's not my favorite musician, I have to say, but it's a great one. I mean, and he just did things that are amazing. I mean, he really invented the symphony. I mean, the symphony didn't exist as we know it now. And he put some things apart, and it has happened many, many times. So I don't think it's the end.
I'm curious about your question, because it's the first time that I've heard you sort of utter the possibility of breaking away from that sort of end point out of reach. So I'm very curious in terms of sort of where is it, that doesn't seem like something that you said unthought. Where are you seeing that?
I guess I think of myself
It seems like suddenly Hegel is maybe not the not the primo figure for you if you're...
No, I'm still Hegel.
Okay.
because Hegel, in making art and architecture a historical discipline, at that moment he also had to predict its possible end. That comes with the territory. So, but I think of myself, and I think a little bit Peter is in the same camp of someone who thinks a lot about end game, sort of end games. I like, Duchamp is end game, Cage is end game, Mies is in. So I think of myself as an end game thinker, except when lately I've tried to push beyond that. I don't come up with continuity, I come up with break. Mm-hmm. I think break is, for me, something much more fearful than an end game, because the end game is always slightly out of reach, right? But I actually think we may have to begin to think about the possibility of a break. And breaks have happened before, as Jorge said. This is, in some way, this is not that radical, but it's not something we're, I think, consciously thinking about the possibility of at the mm-hmm. moment, at least not in these series of conferences.
I think that's a very interesting point.
Yes, Matthew.
Mr. Eisenman, you asked in your lecture about what we are learning, and I just want to mention something that happened to us last week. I'm in the fourth semester, so it's the second year of the MR1 program, and we had a couple workshops with the principles of ACTAR publishing. And we had, after our second workshop, as a class, we really there was a consensus that it was one of the most fruitful experiences to have our work critiqued on the level of graphic design. And so I guess I'm curious about the relationship, but also the contrast between what is architecture and also what is the representation of architecture and the role of essentially the graphic representation of architecture. And it seems like at times the graphic representation of architecture seems even more important than architecture itself, here at least. That's what I feel. So I'm wondering what your response is to that.
Well, I would argue that probably the graphic, I mean, if we're talking about, I am anti-Photoshop. And to me, to win a competition these days, you got to have an expert Photoshop guy in your office who can take your dumb drawings and turn them into graphic representation that is a wow. And we just entered a competition against Zaha. And when you know what you're going against, and especially when you're going against her in Abu Dhabi, you're in a double problem, right? And I have seen Zaha's Photoshop. I must confess, I loved her drawings at the time of the peak a lot more than I liked the Photoshop. So I'm the wrong guy to ask. Maybe you ought to ask these people, because I'm anti-Photoshop. I don't think Photoshop deals with ideas. I think it blurs ideas. We're doing a housing project in Milan, and all of my assistants say, we got to have more trees. We got to have more trees. And I said, trees just cover up and can't see the project. And they said, the client doesn't want to see the project. They want to see the trees. And you should see what these kids in my office do to what I think is architecture, or, you know. And he's probably right that the client doesn't want to see. And I said, how come? They're saying, we just have to do a facade. And I said, how can you do a facade without a plan? What, are you kidding? We don't need plans. Just do a facade. So I am a little bit perplexed about, representation, I have to tell you. It's probably a little late for me.
Yes.
He's coming.
It's a true story.
Yeah. Hello, I also have a question coming out of the
the other question about what we're learning here, and my short reply to that is I would offer that our professors do not so much teach us something as they shape a space to challenge our notions away from the shadows of thought to a staging in the wider world. In this frame, the weight is on us more than them, as it should be, but at least I am quite happy with that exchange of time and resources.
Did you take your lecture notes on your iPhone?
Yes. Yeah, sometimes I take them on a computer, but this is not as extensive.
Wow. Steve, I mean, that's nothing compared to that.
Your body eventually learns where the tips of your fingers are, subconsciously, with practice.
But isn't your answer to what I've said precisely what I wanted to provoke, for you to think about what it is you're learning?
I'd hope so.
Isn't that a good thing?
I thank you for that.
Yeah, because I'm curious.
That's
curious
good provocation.
What the question's going to be, because you've already
yes.
made the answer.
Well, this is something else. It's for Mr. Eisenman, regarding your framing of architecture as a handling of, and you touched on it tonight, handling the relation of subject to object. Doesn't the bubble of novel architectural production, for example, a 30 buildings in 6 months phenomenon, that can lead to profitable market logics far more freakonomic than a Brooks Brothers in New Jersey, doesn't that eventually insist upon bringing the process of form making out of this alienated or abstracted market separation, where decisions are made far away from the users, into a kind of immediacy of a process that the architect shaping the growth of buildings from their context, including the participants. I think that this is a birth rather than a death of theory and practice, but the two can be related. I'm curious how you or anyone else would feel on that.
I'm very pleased with your answer, number one. What I want to say is that I would like to answer, since if I raise the subject, I think the birth is not the birth of the new. That's the difference. I think it's the birth of something else. And as long as we're not thinking that this is a new birth, but another birth, then I think that's fine. And I think to teach the new. I had a dean of an architectural school say to me, geez, a lot of things happened to me last week. Said to me that we teach the future in our school. Our school is about teaching the future. And I thought, how the hell do you do that? You know?
What?
It wasn't me.
No, it wasn't Sarah. a very well-known dean, right?
Yeah.
Pride's, what?
Definitely yeah. wasn't me.
Yeah. Really? So I don't think that, and the break that Michael is talking about in this future have nothing to do with, I mean, I think break is fine, future is fine, but it's not about the new. It's about how we learn from what was and what is about proceeding forward and understanding the changes. Because if we think we're in the same moment of time as learning from Las Vegas, then we are in out of it, right? And we have to understand what are the forces that operate on a great architect, and I say that because Frank is a great architect, that operate on him to need to produce 30 different projects in 6 months, then we have to ask ourselves a question. And that's what I think our education, what you showed me, that this is what education is about, because you've asked and answered the question for me. Anybody?
I have two questions, one for Professor Whiting, the other one for Professor Eisenman. Both are related. Professor Whiting, you've been associated with the post-critical, even though
we... Projective.
Well, no, you associate yourself with the projective, but many people, correctly or incorrectly...
Erroneously
associate you with the post-critical.
Post-critical.
What is projective?
So I'd be curious to hear you explain this, but let's say there's something strange about the post-critical... as you will probably agree, being critical of criticality. And for Professor Eisenman, In the same way, I think, or not in, in a similar pattern, you say that there's no zeitgeist perhaps possible today. But in some sense, what you've been arguing, in my opinion, for a while, is that, in fact, this is a zeitgeist, that the zeitgeist is that there is no zeitgeist. So could both of you answer these paradoxes?
Nice paradoxes. No, I think, I mean, it's that's precisely why we use the term projective. Bob Solomon and myself have never used the term post-critical, precisely because the point is it stems from a productive critical project. Our criticism was of when when the critical project became a sort of knee-jerk formula. And it's that school of thought that we were criticizing. It wasn't, I mean, we even praised two masters of the critical in that article, which is Peter and Michael. So for sort of setting a foundation for a productive form of criticality. So the fact that that has been so misunderstood, I thank you for the opportunity to yet again clarify this point, because I think it's actually pretty clear in that short article. But so there's no paradox there as far as I'm concerned. You can deal with the zeitgeist
paradox. Yeah, of course. No, I want to deal with the paradox of the projective, because that just obfuscates the point, because I believe in project, as we, as either you or Jorge talked about, the notion of, I think you did, of having a project. I don't think having a project and the projective are the same thing, number one, right? And I, for the life of me, don't understand what means to be the projective, because if project is about projecting in some way, then what is the projective? See, I find that a...
I see them as more synonymous than you do. So it's I think you're made nervous by the whiff of a change in the projective being a change model from what you've been
projective
advocating.
Is something that looks to the future.
Right.
Project doesn't necessarily do that. Project.
Well, actually, no, I disagree. I think that a project does look to the future, because it's a. I think that
could be a
let's say yeah, and that's true. It can be a near future, but for me, a project that only looks to the past is not a productive project.
See, I think what you mean by productive is that the whiff of Adorno, Benjamin, the Frankfurt School is erased, and I don't think that that's a smart idea, but that's what you really mean. Let's come clean about it.
Yeah. You're heading in the right direction.
You know damn well I'm heading in the right direction. You know? And I would think that a lot of people would have a problem with that formulation.
Well,
that's why she posed it that way.
That's good. Well, I'm just, let's put it out on the table.
No, that's good. I think that's valid.
Yeah.
Productive, even.
Let's project. Let's be projective, continuing out and onward. Thank you all.
Thank
for a
you.
Wonderful
evening. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.